I want to speak about the story of field responsiveness, I would say, in a brief time, 20 minutes. So 20 minutes to summarize 20 years. First of all, I have to declare as a member of the Medical Advisory Board of Persian. So what is field responsiveness? You know, what is it? Field responsiveness is defined as the capacity of the heart to significantly increase its stroke volume, or its cardiac output, in response to a volume challenge. And you know this kind of relationship, the Frank-Starling curve, stroke volume and preload, and you know that the shape is curvilinear. And you know that if you give fluid, you increase preload, and if you increase preload while the heart is operating on the steep part, you can increase stroke volume. And this condition is called preload responsiveness. And if the heart is operating on the flat part, you have no increase in stroke volume, and this condition is called preload unresponsiveness. Of course, feed infusion will increase stroke volume of the left ventricle only if both ventricles are preload responsive. So, feed responsiveness, which is a clinical concept, is equivalent to biventricular preload responsiveness, which is more physiological concept. So, what have we learned over the past 20 years? 10 points only. The first thing is that not every patient with acute cardiac failure is field responsive. And we learned this from the literature, of course. This is an analysis of the literature we did with Frank Michel years ago. And we were surprised to observe that only 50% of patients respond to field administration while they were in circuit failure, eligible for fluid infusion. So it means that 50% of patients do not respond. And this is why the concept of fluid responsive is interesting, to identify fluid non-responders, as Maurizio Ciccone said. Second point, fluid loading is in unresponsive. Patients may favor pulmonary edema and may decrease oxygen delivery. Why it may favor pulmonary edema? Because there is not only the Frank-Starling curve, the systolic function of the ventricle, we also have the diastolic function of the ventricle. And the diastolic function is ventricular preload as a volume, and the left ventricular and diastolic pressure. And we have this kind of shape, meaning that if you give fluid to non-responders, you will increase pressure, the left ventricular and diastolic pressure. So this is a double penalty. You do not increase stroke volume, but you increase the left ventricular and diastolic pressure, which is not the objective of our resuscitation. So we need to identify non-responders. Another thing, if you give fluid, you will create some hemodilution, you will decrease hemoglobin concentration, and if you have non-responders patients, it's not good because oxygen delivery finally decreases. This is what we showed in this study with Xavier Monet. Only in responders, oxygen delivery increases. So, again, we have to identify non-responders to avoid this mechanism. Third, excessive fluid administration may cause harm. We also learned this over the past years. This is one of the studies illustrating this. The SOAP study, Jean-Louis Vincent and co-workers, showing that the positive community fluid balance is an independent factor associated with mortality. So too much fluid may cause harm. So if we add number one, number two, and number three, of course, it is obvious that prediction of fluid responsiveness is important. Number five, static measures of preload cannot reliably predict fluid responsiveness. This is also something we learned over the past 20 years. You know why? Because I spoke about Frank-Starling curve, but there is no one single Frank-Starling curve, but multiple Frank-Starling curves, depending on the contractility, mostly on the contractility of the ventricle. So if you measure preload with whatever marker, pressure, volume. A single value of prolud cannot tell you if the patient is prolud responsive or not, because you don't know about his own Frank-Starling curve. So assessing prolud is not assessing prolud responsiveness, and static measures of prolud cannot reliably predict prolud responsiveness. This is logical. And this was confirmed by many studies. This is a meta-analysis by Paul Merrick about CVP, central venous pressure. And they included 43 studies and 1,800 patients. It's not negligible. And they found that the summary area under the ROC curve for the prediction of prolud responsiveness using CVP was only 0.56. It is exactly like tossing a coin. This is one of the reasons why CVP disappeared from the surviving sepsis campaign guidelines. Number six, dynamic tests are reliable to predict for responsiveness. And this is now recommended by the Open Society of Intensive Care Medicine, this consensus conference paper, but also by the last recommendations of the surviving sepsis campaign. Why? Because with dynamic variable, we can identify the slope of the Frank-Starling curve. If we can quantify this, we have the answer of our question. So we can use dynamic indices, and there are two categories of indices. We have heart-lung interaction indices, and we have passive leg raising test. What about heart-lung interaction indices? Briefly, the idea behind is that the more the cardiac output or the stroke volume changes with mechanical ventilation, the more likely the patient is prolud responsive, to be brief. And for this, we have some dynamic variables. We have, for example, pulse pressure variation or stroke volume variation. You are familiar with this concept of pulse pressure variation. You know, pulse pressure is the difference between systolic and diastolic pressure. And when you have a large pulse pressure variation, like mechanical ventilation, you can assume that the patient and the heart of the patient is working on the steep part of the Frank-Starling relationship and could be prolud responsive. And the opposite is true for low pulse pressure variation. In the past, with my colleagues in Bicêtre, we proposed to calculate pulse pressure variation as the difference between the maximal value and the minimal value during the mechanical ventilation cycle, divided by the mean of the two values and expressed as a percentage. And we show that in septic shock patients, PPV was far better than CVP and POP to predict prolud responsiveness. Look at the area under the ROC curve. And it was confirmed by many other studies. This is a meta-analysis by a Chinese team looking at patients ventilated with a tidal volume of at least 8 ml per kilogram. And they included 22 studies and 800 patients, and they found that the average area under the ROC curve was 0.94, which is good, and the threshold value was 12%. And now it's possible to monitor pulse pressure variation to have the value automatically calculated, displayed on the screen of many monitors now. It is also possible to derive stroke volume from the arterial pressure waveform analysis. You know this kind of devices. And also it's possible to have the value of stroke volume variation from this pulse contour analysis devices. And again, this is automatically calculated and displayed on the screen. Also, some people like Massimo Antonelli, just in front of me, Mr. President, used plethysmographic signal variation using very simple pulse oximeters. And this meta-analysis by his group, they showed that the area under the ROC curve for all these studies was good, 0.85, not perfect. Not perfect probably because some patients in these studies received vasopressors, norepinephrine and others. And in this study we did with Xavier Monet in our unit, we showed that the plethysmographic variability index, PVI here, was not as good as PPV and SVV to predict responsiveness. So we have to be very careful if you use vasopressors and when we interpret this variability of the plethysmographic signal. Possible also to use the respiratory variation of the inferior vena cava diameter in patients with mechanical ventilation, ventilated with a tidal volume of at least 8 ml, it works very well. This is a study we did with Mark Fessel. And also, we can use the transesophageal approach and to look at the variation of the diameter of the superior vena cava. But there is always but. But there are many limitations to use all these variables using mechanical ventilation, and especially tachyarrhythmias, spontaneous breathing activity, low tidal volume, low compliance of the lung. This is why we have the tests. For example, we have an expiratory occlusion test, and I don't want to go into detail, but with Xavier Monet, again, we use the PICO and the pulse contour cardiac output analysis to test this new test. At that time, it was in 2009. And we interrupted the ventilator for 15 seconds, and we look at the changes in cardiac output at the same time. And we observe that patients who will respond to fluid administration later, where in the blue one also increased that cardiac output during this test, while the other ones did not. So it is a good way to identify responders and non-responders. But we found that the threshold value was only 5%. It was acceptable with the precision of this pulse contour analysis method, but it's not always compatible with, for example, echocardiography. Because you know that using velocity time integral, the least significant change for this technique is around 10%. So we cannot rely on this threshold value. This is why recently with Mathieu Josviak and Xavier Monet in our unit, we proposed to combine two tests, the and expiratory occlusion test and the and inspiratory occlusion test. And we measure velocity time integral using echocardiography at baseline and after fluid administration. But in the meantime, we also perform and expiratory occlusion, which should increase velocity time integral in the fluid responders. And we also perform and inspiratory occlusion, which should normally decrease VTI in fluid responders. And in fact, we wanted to know if the threshold value, if we combine, and if we add the absolute, we add the two values in absolute way, we can have a threshold more compatible with the precision of the technique. And this is what we found, to be very brief. We found that with the combination, we obtained 13% for the threshold value. 13%, which is compatible with the precision of echocardiography. And also, we have a new test, which is the tidal volume challenge. Because we know that during low tidal volume ventilation, which is now a very frequent way to ventilate patients, PPV, pulse pressure variation, as well as stroke volume variation, are not good. This is a paper by Daniel De Backer, and showing that when you ventilate with a tidal volume of at least 8 ml, it's okay. The area under the Rho curve is okay, but if you use less, the area under the curve is not as good, and the threshold value is also lower. This is why, with Sheila Mayatra and the group of Mumbai, India, we propose a new test, which is to increase tidal volume from 6 to 8 ml per kilogram only during 1 minute, or less than 1 minute. And we found that at 6 ml per kilogram, the area under the Rho curve was not good, as found by Daniel De Backer. When we increased to 8, we had a better area under the Rho curve, but what was excellent was the changes in PPV between 6 and 8 in absolute value. For example, you have 7% at 6, you cannot trust this value. You increase tidal volume, now it is 11, you can assume that the patient will respond to fluid administration. Also, sometimes you have a PPV value which is in a gray zone between 9 and 13%. And this was described by Maxime Canesson and co-workers. And in this situation, this is a zone of uncertainty. You don't know exactly if the patient is fluid responder or not. And one possibility proposed last year by a Chinese team is to increase tidal volume also in this situation. And they started from 8 ml per kilogram, and they increased to 12. And as you can observe, the area under the curve, the raw curve, was better for 12 compared to 8, and they could predict for responsiveness. Of course, food administration was given at 8 ml, not at 12. 12 was only for the test. Also, we have passive leg raising test. It is another test which is doable in all the situations. You don't need mechanical ventilation for interpreting this test. You know this maneuver consisting in moving the bed of the patient, and this transfers blood from the legs and from the abdominal compartment towards the intra-thoracic compartment, and this should increase preload. This study we did with Thierry Boulin years and years ago, and we measured right atrial pressure, but also POP, pulmonary arterial occlusion pressure, during passive leg raising. And in all most patients, we observe an increase in right atrial pressure and an increase in POP, confirming that this maneuver is able to increase preload. And after the test, just after the test, all the values return to baseline, confirming that the test is reversible and there is no risk of pulmonary edema, for example. So it mimics food challenge, but unlike food challenge, no fluid is infused and the effects are totally reversible. Of course, we need to monitor this test. We need to measure something. And we need to measure cardiac output and to look at the short-term increase in cardiac output in these patients during the test. And we need a real-time cardiac output monitor to do this. And in this meta-analysis with Xavier Monet and Paul Merrick, we recently included 21 clinical studies that addressed the issue of fluid responsiveness using passive leg raising. And we found that in almost 1,000 patients, again, it's not negligible, that the area under the rocker was 0.95, which is good, and the threshold value was 10%. And the interest of this test, if you can use it with no mechanical ventilation or in patients with mechanical ventilation with some spontaneous breathing activity. And this worked very well. The area in this study with Xavier Monet was 1 compared to the value of PPV in this situation of spontaneous breathing activity. And now we are very happy because even the surviving sepsis campaign guidelines recommend to use passive leg raising tests. So it is good. Number 7. Protocols using dynamic tests are associated with improved outcome. Is this true for surgery during the operating room, in the operating room during surgery? If you use strategies based on PPV or SVV compared to control, you have better results in terms of complication post-surgical outcome. But it is also true for patients coming from the operating room to the ICU, and this is a recent analysis of the literature showing that compared to control group in randomized studies, you have a better outcome in terms of mortality if you use these dynamic indices compared to control group, including CVP. Number 8, and it is almost finished. Number 8, testing preload responsiveness is not advised for initiation of infusion in shock states. I mean that, given that hypovolemia is present in almost 100% of cases, shock state cases, and in septic shock we can say 100%, it is logical to infuse a fluid bolus early without using any predictor of fluid responsiveness. I would say be smart, but not too much at the beginning of the resuscitation, and don't waste too much time. After number 9, you should look at the presence of preload responsiveness to decide to continue or not fluid administration. And the decision of continuing fluid administration is based on the persistence of hemodynamic instability or signs of peripheral hypoperfusion, motor skin, hypotension, oliguria, etc., plus the presence of preload responsiveness and limited risk of fluid overload to continue fluid administration. And number 10, to decide to stop fluid administration, you should base your decision on either the disappearance of hemolytic instability, of course, or not and, or the presence of preload unresponsiveness, you should stop, and the high risk of feed overload. And you can assess this risk whatever you want, but in my unit we use the extravasal lung water measurements and the pulmonary vascular permeability index measurements. So this is the end of my talk, and I thank you very much for your attention.